One thing a lot of people ask us about is, can you value an early stage company? A lot of people are saying, no, you can't value early stage companies because there's just too much uncertainty. You're talking about companies with no revenues, no assets, no EBITDA, no profit. How can you come up with a valuation based on that kind of information? Well, the fact of the matter is, deals are done every day. And in order to do a deal, regardless of whether it's equity or convertible debt, you still have to have a valuation in order to take capital in and give equity or convertible debt shares out. So all investment types have uncertainty. Regardless of whether you're investing in real estate, stocks, or bonds, or venture capital, they all have uncertainty. And it's built in to the valuation models. So how can we reduce uncertainty in venture capital valuation models so that we can come to reasonable outcomes? Our suggestion is that we do multiple valuations rather than just one. Multiple valuation methodologies take lots of different data sets, and they make it so that we can make reasonable valuation assumptions, not just from one or two different ways of looking at the deal. So one way we look at it is called the venture capital method. It's one of the most popular methods for early stage valuation. It starts by modeling the exit valuation. So we'll look at what the revenues are going to be for the company in year five, if that's the exit model. And then we're going to say, what are the comps? What are other transactions happening? What's the likelihood of this company having a 5x or 7x multiple of revenues when the time comes? Once we've modeled the exit, then we'll discount back to future. It's a discounted cash flow model in some ways. And we'll discount it typically at about a 60% IRR for venture capital deals. That comes to about a 10x return for investors over a 5-year period. Another method we'll use doesn't look at exits at all. It'll start with what other comparable transactions are at. This is called the scorecard method. So we start by looking at hundreds of transactions for early stage companies, say in technology, across the country. We'll find maybe an average valuation of $3 million. We'll start with that as our baseline, and then we'll add and subtract based on the opportunity size, the team, the product, the competition, and so on. And we'll add and subtract to come up with a valuation for the company based on what the market is paying for other companies. We have lots of other methods we can use. Some are based on risk-adjusted models, or they're financially based. They may look at how much capital the company is going to need over its lifespan. There's lots of different types of inputs. The important thing is there are a lot of different data sets that you can use for each different valuation model. If you take them all together and you figure out a mean, median, and standard deviation, now you can get a pretty defensible range for valuation. Breaking valuation down into lots of discrete elements also helps for more rational negotiation rather than just arguing over big numbers. Now once we've broken things down and we can say, How good is this team? Do they really have the people who can make this happen? Or what about the product? And do we have defensible IP? What's the competition? Are they really as scary as we think? We can start by analyzing all of those and build those into our models rather than just arguing the big numbers. So in conclusion, smart CEOs will work up multiple valuation models and have a solid valuation story with lots of good comparable research. Smart investors will do the same thing, and both can come to reasonable negotiated outcomes.